I don't usually remember my dreams, but one of our children was in my dream last night. I told my wife about this morning. I said, I dreamed about it, I mentioned the child, and I said the child wasn't chosen for something, and the child was very hurt, and they were looking sad, and I leaned over and said, Pastor will never hurt you. I love you. And the child smiled, and then I went,
Word of God.
With this sermon, I end this short series on the church's book, the Bible. And then, Lord willing, next Lord's Day, I want to begin a series that will only last for the month of September called A Matter of Life and Debt. What the Bible says about debt. I have already purchased a 5-gallon water bottle that I'm going to have up here on the platform with a pair of scissors stuck in the neck of the bottle. And while I'm preaching, as the Word of God comes forth, if you are convicted by the Word of God regarding debt, you are invited to come up and in real time, publicly, cut up a credit card and stick the remains of it, stick that in the water bottle. Amen. I've lost some of you. I'm in debt, Pastor. I'm not doing that. That's how you'll get out. More about that next Wednesday. 2 Timothy chapter 3. I want to read one verse only, and then I'll be alluding to other passages as we go along. But this is the overarching verse for this series. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Let's review, shall we? All scripture, says this text, is breathed out by God. The Greek word is actually a compound word which means God breathed. All scripture is breathed out by God. All scripture, according to this text, is profitable. We also looked at the great truth in scripture that scripture is divine in its origin and durable in its quality. That is, heaven and earth will pass away, said Jesus. My word will not pass away. You remember that from Mark 13:31. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord abides forever, stands forever, says Isaiah 40, verse 8. The utterances, the proclamations of humanity change and fade, but God's word stands sure and is unchanging. In this sermon, I want to remind you of, and perhaps inform some of you, of some facts about the church's book. And then I want to celebrate what some of the ancients say of Scripture, and I'll even tell you what some skeptics, some non-believers say about the Bible. The church's book was written in 3 languages. You know that. The New Testament was written in Greek. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew, with some sections of it written in Aramaic. Was written over about a 1,500-year span from approximately 1400 BC to about 100 years after the birth of Christ. It was written by 40 authors who were diverse in occupation. Prophets, fishermen, King contains 17 historical books, 5 poetical books, 17 prophetic books, 4 gospels, 21 epistles. It contains 66 books in this one church's book, 39 books of the Old Testament, 27 books in the New Testament. There are 1,189 chapters in the Bible, 929 chapters in the Old Testament, 260 in the New Testament. The longest chapter in the Bible, it's really not a chapter, but the longest section would be Psalm 119. The shortest is Psalm 117. Longest verse in the Bible, Esther chapter 8, verse 9. The shortest verse in the Bible, you all know it. It's 2 words long. It's in John 11:35. And it is?
Jesus.
Yes, some of you always counted on that one when they were going around the table when you were growing up. I want everyone to recite the scripture. You hoped you could get Jesus wet. We believe the church's book to be the ultimate authority for faith and practice. We believe in the book. We preach the book here. We teach the book here. We urge people to live by the book. And some people see that as something negative. Are you just so Bible-oriented? You're always saying, the Bible said, the Bible said. Yes, thank you for knowing. That's nothing to be ashamed of. We rely on the book. We need the wisdom of God. The Barna Group is a Christian polling organization. It is the Christian Church's version of the Gallup poll. George Barna has just done excellent work in polling our population. He published in 2014 a State of the Bible document. People were asked if the Bible contains everything a person needs now to live a meaningful life. That was the question of the poll. Does the Bible contain everything a person needs to live a meaningful life? 35% of millennials, age 18 to 29, said yes. Only 35% said the book contains what we need to live a meaningful life. 49% of busters who were surveyed, that is people ages 30 to 48, answered yes. The Bible contains everything a person needs to live a meaningful life. 55% of boomers, ages 49 to 67, answered yes. 63% of elders, that is ages 68 and older, answered yes. It's very clear that the older you get, the more you need. The more you see the need of the book. Only 35% of millennials said yes. But nearly twice that of elders, those 68 and older. Clearly, not everyone is on board with the idea that the Bible is the authoritative book for life. John Shelby Spahn, born 1931, still living, he's retired, is an Episcopal bishop. For 21 years, he was the bishop of Newark, New Jersey. And in the 1990s, he's quite a controversial figure. In the 1990s, Spahn wrote a book titled Rescuing the Bible from Fundamentalism. A bishop rethinks the meaning of scripture. And Bishop Spahn wrote that many doctrinal and biblical beliefs to which we have held are no longer relevant or believable. That was so sad to me. Because the Word of God doesn't change. If it was believable 100 years ago, it's believable now. If Jesus was the Son of God, then he's the Son of God now, since this doesn't change. If John 14:6 is true, and I believe it is, where Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by me. If that was true when Jesus said it, it's true now. But Spong said that there are certain beliefs to which we have held that are no longer relevant or believable. And he questions, among many other beliefs, the Trinity, Israel as God's chosen people, the miracles performed by Christ, the bodily resurrection of Jesus, eternal punishment for the unbelieving, and the devil as an actual being. He says all of those should be called into question. They're not all relevant or believable. That made me so sad. Bill Maher, the rather irreverent comedian, talk show host, said, quote, I have a problem with people who take the Constitution loosely and the Bible literally. I have a problem with people who take the Constitution loosely and the Bible literally. My problem is the opposite. I got a problem with people who take the Constitution literally and the Bible loosely. That's why we're in the condition we're in now.
Amen.
I'll say amen myself. I don't need your amen. Listen to Richard Dawkins, the professed atheist, in his book, The God Delusion. To be fair, much of the Bible is not systematically evil, but just plain weird, as you would expect of a chaotically cobbled together anthology of disjointed documents, composed, revised, translated, distorted, and improved by hundreds of anonymous authors, editors, and copyists, unknown to us and mostly unknown to each other, spanning 9 centuries. End of quote. Interesting. Dan Brown, author of The Lost Symbol, quote, you can point to the alleged miracles of the Bible or any other religious text, but they are nothing but old stories fabricated by man and then exaggerated over time. End of quote. I'm not interested in this irreverent, snarky stance. I hope you're not either. This book has stood the test of time. I dare you to name any other book that has lasted this long and has been held in such high esteem as this book, the Word of God. Show me another book that doesn't undergo revisions after revisions after revisions, where the author apologizes that he or she said something 20 years ago, but they're now rethinking their stance on that. And so here's a new edition. So when new editions come out of this, it's just a different font, different translation, same truth. Flower fades, the word of our God abides forever. If we can decide what facts we'll believe and which we won't, we don't have a reliable source of authority. If we can decide that today I believe this, but tomorrow I won't, or that I know the principle here, but that's usually what should be done. However, you don't understand my circumstances. No. What does the word say? I've spoken to people who were shacking up, and especially if the person shacking, if one of the shackies, is a believer, when called on this lifestyle choice they made, almost to a person, the person says to me, well, you know, I know that's not what we should be doing, but... And then they proceed to give me their take and begin to try to convince me that the principle, the moral principle of only going to bed with one who is your marriage partner, the principle is somehow not applicable to them. Mm. They say, I know, Reverend, but... Then they say, and it could be something practical such as, well, you know, I was in an apartment and she was in an apartment. No sense in paying two rents. We get married in 9 months. So, you know, and that's where they stop. You know, and I said, no, I don't know. And why can't you go live with your mom? Why can't you go live with your auntie? Why are you trying to convince me that your standing is all right when it's not all right? Well, Reverend, I know we're not supposed to lie, right? But let me tell you what happened. when it came time to pay my taxes, you know, I had a lot of money that I made, you know, under the table, you know what I'm saying? When I got paid in cash, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, I know we're supposed to tell the truth, but you know. I said, I don't know. Tell me why you are going to try to convince me that in your case, lying is all right. It's normally wrong, but for you, you get a pass. Tell me how that squares with this word, which doesn't change. Just explain how that works. And they stop talking. See, the great thing about this book is that it says what it says. And tomorrow it's going to say the same thing. So instead of trying to get this to square up with our choices, here's an idea. See if you can start squaring your choices with this book. And when we study this book, we are better prepared to speak to the skeptic, to the critic, to the agnostic, to the seeker, to the infidel. Because we've got the word in us. I remind you of 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. It's a great memory verse. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you. With meekness and fear. Amen. The more word you have in you, the more you're able to declare, defend your choices, your lifestyle. Let me hasten. I'm near the end. I want to tell you about two biblical writers who framed their love of the word in wonderful language that I want you to see. The first is Ezekiel. Ezekiel used a culinary metaphor, and he was actually led to it by God. But there's a passage in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 3. Well, maybe you'll turn to it with me. Would you turn to Ezekiel, please? Let me show it to you. Just access it on your smart device, Ezekiel chapter 3. You're using a print Bible. If I were you, I'd go to the table of contents and look up Ezekiel in the Old Testament. It's either in alphabetical order, or those books are listed in the order in which they appear in the Old Testament. Look for Ezekiel, E-Z-E-K-I-E-A-I-E-L. Go to Ezekiel chapter 3. No shame in using the table of contents. Ezekiel chapter 3, this is a great passage. I want you to see how Ezekiel understands the value of the book, or in his language, the scroll. This is Ezekiel writing. Moreover, God said to me, Son of man, eat what you find. Eat this scroll. This is the papyrus. This is the scroll on which the words of God are written. This is essentially his Bible. And go speak to the house of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he caused me to eat that scroll. And he said to me, Son of man, feed your belly and fill your stomach with this scroll that I give you. So I ate, and it was in my mouth like honey in sweetness. Then he said to me, Son of man, go to the house of Israel and speak with my words to them. You know, when you get the word in you, when you digest it, you have much more to say to others. You have the word in you, and that's what comes out.
Yes.
Ezekiel says that this church's book, this scroll, is so valuable, I want to internalize it. Hold that thought when you go to the second writer to whom I want to point you. David. David said in Psalm 119 that this book kept him holy. Mm-hmm. And this book delighted him. And in fact, this book counseled him. And Pastor, where did he get that? It's in Psalm 119. That is the longest chapter. Although it's a separate, it's a psalm. It's a psalm. But Psalm 119 is the longest chapter, so to speak, in the Bible. Verse 11 of Psalm 119. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Do you see what he's saying? Yeah. When I internalized your word, it kept me from a sinful lifestyle.
Yes.
The more and more word I take on, the more and more I digest the church's book, the Bible, the more and more I'm able to go out and live the kind of life that you determined for me, oh God.
Amen.
I can live a holy life because I have your word in me.
Yes.
I've taken on this book. Look at verse 24, if you're still there in Psalm 119. Your testimonies also are my delight and my counselors. Oh, isn't that wonderful? Your word counsels me. Note that in Psalm 119, every eighth verse is a comment on the effectiveness of the word. Different terms are used, statute, testimony, law, precept. But if you look at any multiple of the number 8 in Psalm 119, 8, 16, 32, 40, 48, you go right on through. Every eighth verse, there is a comment, a specific comment about the word, about the book, about the law, about the testimony of the Lord, about the precepts, about the statutes. Every eighth verse, David cannot go more than 7 verses without stopping to talk about the book.
Amen.
Look at verse 32. I'll run the course of your commandments, for you shall enlarge my heart. Look at verse 40. Behold, I long for your precepts. You just go right through that entire psalm. Every eighth verse, a celebration of the efficacy of the word, the book. May God create in us a hunger for the Word of God.
Amen.
That we may read it, study, live it out.
Yeah.
I got to tell you about something I'm involved in right now, and then I'm done. I've started a doctoral program at Emory University, a doctor of ministry degree in preaching. I'm part of a cohort of 29 students. The spectrum from very liberal to very conservative. I'm on this end. We spent 3 days together a couple weeks ago, and then most of our classes are online. I am greatly disturbed by the ultra-liberal person who wants to water this down so much that nobody is offended by it.
I listened to them. One person was leading us in worship and said, "I will bless the Lord at all times. The Lord's praises will continue to be in my mouth." They didn't want to say he. They didn't want to say his praises. They said, "I will bless the Lord at all times. The Lord's praises will be in my mouth." I want to make sure they didn't say he, because they didn't want to offend the feminists. You don't want to call God Father, for that's too patriarchal and is very detrimental to women who are struggling with issues of spirituality. I got a word for you. God has declared himself to be our Father. He's also declared himself to be our mother. I don't have a problem with that. But you don't need to try to build a whole case on let's not call God Father. Well, that's what he calls himself. What are you going to do with that? Well, you know, we don't want to suggest that, you know, men should be the head of their homes because that's just so sexist. And what we do is we need to open it up and explore all the possibilities. I don't mean to be flippant here, but be careful when you start trying to make this palatable to all. God's word is not so loose that you can do with it whatever you want. It is unchanging. And that we celebrate. Husbands, love your wives. That's what it says.
Yes.
It's not for us to try to figure out, well, you know, but to whom was he speaking? You know, couldn't two women in a committed relationship love each other and that be the same thing? No, that's not the same thing. It says what it says, and it speaks to every culture and every age. And our task is not to figure out how we can change it so that it suits us.
Amen.
Our task is to line up under its weight and its authority.
Yes.
And say yes.
Yes.
So with Philip P. Bliss, I say, sing them over again to me.
Amen.
Wonderful words of life.
Yes.
Let me more of their beauty see. Wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty. Teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words. Wonderful words. Wonderful words of life. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for your book, your word. And we say amen to all we have heard. We say yes to your will. We say yes to your ways. We say yes to your word. You have spoken. The entire church says amen. You have spoken through your word. You have spoken in Jesus Christ. You have spoken through this text. All scripture is breathed out by you and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. And we say amen. We thank you that your word does not change. We find ourselves changing too much. We pray that we would put ourselves with delight under the authority of your book, your unchanging, infallible word.
May we eat it as did Ezekiel. May we take it into our hearts as did David. That we might never be the same. Now, beloved, while your heads are bowed, perhaps, maybe your eyes are closed, maybe you're in a reflective mood and mode. Maybe you're here today and say, Pastor Farmer, you were talking to me. How did you know? That's the Spirit of the Lord talking to you, sir, madam. Maybe you're here and you're saying, Pastor Farmer, I am not a person who has given myself to what the Bible teaches. I have my own ideas. I get my ideas from talk shows, radio shows. But I want to know what the Bible says about how I'm supposed to be living. I'd like to talk with someone about that. Pastor Farmer, could you pray for me, and then could I chat with someone about how I could begin that life of being a person of the book, of the word? Secondly, you might be here, you say, Pastor Farmer, I say amen to everything that was said, everything that was proclaimed. I'm a believer. I want to be in a Bible teaching church, and I believe this is the place for me. Would you pray for me, and then could I chat with someone about how I can begin the process of becoming part of this church? As we sing, we're going to sing, let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. If I'm describing you, I'll be standing here in front of you, God, as we sing. Let the church say amen.
Take my feet.
you leave, I want to remind you, I did not mention this in prayer time, but Dolores Rose has suffered a loss in her family. Her daughter-in-law's, her former daughter-in-law's husband passed very, very suddenly this week in his 50s. And of a heart attack, apparently, and that's been a very difficult situation, as you can imagine. That memorial service is Wednesday. We want to be in prayer for Dolores, for her grandson, particularly her grandson Isaac, for whom this man was stepfather and a vital part of his life. We want to be in prayer for that whole family. Would you please look up and receive the benediction? Now, beloved, go from this place and determine to be people of the book. May the Lord speak to you and may you speak to the Lord. May His words be so internalized that it can be said you ate them. Go. May you be fully alive because God is. May you hear His voice speaking through the din, through the cacophony. All this week, may His voice be the loudest one you hear. Go. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Cause His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. Beloved, I love you. The Lord bless you going in. Coming out, down sitting and up rising. And in everything you do,
yes.
And you see Jesus.